showed you today is a very simple study, and it represents, to me, a place where hypotheses can be generated for further work. So, feel free to join. All right, so the group I work on is called Pagarodia. So that's these guys at Pagarodia. And they're a super family within Decapoda, but they come from an infraorder called Animura. Animura is a really interesting infraorder because they have some really special features that are very unique. And that's, they have a reduced fifth and fourth walking leg. And in most cases, those are modified for some other purpose, such as in the case of Pagaroids, anchoring themselves in gastropod shell. So that's a unique feature that's shared by all Animura. In the traditional taxonomy, which is generally based on morphological features, Animura has a very different structure than we see in molecular studies today. So Pagaroidia is here in red, and it's traditionally thought to be monophyletic, and including hermit crabs, asymmetrical hermit crabs, and symmetrical hermit crabs. But one of the features of this taxonomic system is that it excludes, in blue, arcane crabs. So a lot of the data that we're gathering today, which you'll see, contributes to the hypothesis that maybe these king crabs actually are asymmetrical hermit crabs, evolutionarily speaking. Again, I'm going to focus on the Gulf of Mexico, just because that's the material I have the most readily available. So in our collection, we have 16,000 catalog lots of decapods from the Gulf, and we have a lot of good data from the Gulf of Mexico, both pre- and post-spill, and it's just an incredible resource. So that's where that data is coming from. And here's some great photos that are provided to me by my advisor, who's been very involved in trying to provide photo vouchers to go with gene sequences and also taxonomic descriptions. So I think that's an important step towards sort of modernizing the way we approach taxonomy. All right, so there's been a huge impact of molecular data in decapod systematics, but importantly to me, in Pagaroid systematics. And the tree you see on the left is based purely on molecular data. It's a multi-gene study by Tsang et al. In 2011. And what you see is we see our Pagaroids here in red, and our lithotids, our king crabs, are still in blue. And so what we're seeing is we're not seeing that nice superfamily delineation between asymmetrical hermit crabs and king crabs. We're seeing king crabs as being nested inside of those asymmetrical hermits. This isn't an outlandish hypothesis. This has been controversial over decades. And so it's gone back and forth because there is morphological support for it if you look at developmental features, and also there's some dimorphic adult asymmetry in king crabs as well of the abdomen. So there is morphological support for it, but molecular data has really started to provide an additional foundation. So those are our king crabs inside of our Pagaroids. Down here you have some asymmetrical hermits. So you'll see as we go on in my data set and this I'm going to talk about here, these symmetrical hermit crabs are very unstable with respect to the rest of the group phylogenetically. So I think that's worth noting, is that we don't know what they're doing. They're kind of doing their own thing. So this study here was in Systematic Biology not too long ago, and it provided a combined morphological and molecular data study of the larger group of Animura. So it did include Pagaroids, but its focus wasn't Pagaroids. And what you see in that tree, which this tree is a Bayesian tree that's made from a morphological matrix and a molecular matrix. And you're seeing in pink, we have part of Pagaroidia, the family Pagaridae. And we have our king crabs, again, inside of that group. So we're seeing Pagaroidia plus king crabs as being a very stable group. What we see in this tree that we can't see in this Tsang tree here is the family Diagenidae, which is the other major family inside of Pagaroidia. We're starting to see it, we're starting to see it break up. It's not monophyletic anymore. In fact, one subgroup allies with Pagaridae and the king crabs, and the other subgroup falls on its own. So now one of our major families is falling apart too. So there's two clades in Diagenidae that separate. I'm going to mostly talk about one of them because one of them is made up almost entirely of a single genus. So this genus Pagaristis is probably the most speciose genus inside of Diagenidae. And Pagaristis, well, Pagaristis and Areopagaristis together, these two genera together, they form the bulk of this clade. And inside that clade, we see three major groupings. We have here a complex called Pagaristis tortugae, which is a group that includes all our deep water peggers. So some of these are quite deep water. We'll see them at 900 feet or 900 meters. We'll see them at 1,200 meters. So they're quite deep. And then up here we have an interesting complex that is an intermixing of Pacific Panamanian species, Gulf species, and Caribbean species. And some of them have a feature I'll address here in a minute. This group is a single genus traditionally, but it's been broken up into two genera in the last decade. And those two genera are Pagaristis and Areopagaristis. Areopagaristis has a problem. It's defined based on its number of gill pairs. So we have these specimens that have been classified as Pagaristis for many, many decades. And someone in the museum in Paris was going through and looked at all of them and looked at their gill pairs and said, wait, some of these have 12 pairs. These aren't Pagaristis. Pagaristis is described as having 13 pairs. Okay, we can't call it that. All right, so then we get Areopagaristis, which is defined by that gill pair reduction. And you can see that here in this figure where Pagaristis has this little gill and Areopagaristis does not. The problem is that this unites otherwise disparate species. And when we apply molecular data to this group, you can see here in purple, here and here and here, that we get a non-monophyletic group. So it's not a phylogenetically stable group, although we like it taxonomically because it's so tiny. But we've got our purples falling apart here. Here's some species inside of Areopagaristis. They're really diverse. The carapace, the shield, is shaped completely differently. This animal is really diminutive. We know it from only one place. This one's very widespread. It's stocky. So there's some serious morphological questions that come up when you consider these to be monophyletic. When you do treat them as monophyletic and use a site likelihoods-based hypothesis testing approach, and KH and SH and AU, they'll fail every time. So anytime I force the constraint on this where I ask Areopagaristis to be monophyletic, the tree will fail. So I don't think it's a real genus. Okay, so one of the complexes inside of Areopagaristis, the Areopagaristis homini complex, this is an interesting complex because it's very unstable with respect to the rest of diagenetic. So if we went back to the Bayesian study that combined molecular and morphological data, this clade here, this Areopagaristis homini, that's found at the base of this big diagenetic clade, it'll sometimes ally with Pagaridae, sometimes it'll ally with the rest of Diagenidae, and the support for that relationship one way or the other is always very low. So it's unstable. And then there's a cryptic clade that emerges in here, which I don't have very many representatives in this tree, but it segregates genetically. And then if you go to look at these animals, here's our Areopagaristis homini sensu stricto, and here's the variant. They don't have a continuous distribution, so this one is from the Gulf, this one is from Panama, and we've never found them overlapping. And the primary difference between the two is in color. So we don't see a lot of other physical features that differentiate them. And that's interesting, because in decapod taxonomy and systematics, color is generally thought to be a throwaway character. So we see these variations in color, and there are some sort of subtle ecomorph, or it's related to substrate type, or there's something. But what we're seeing is a genetic distinction between this color form with the golden eye stalks and this crescent, and this color form with the blue eye stalks and this really vibrant blue spot. So I think there's a story there. Our other complex that we're going to talk about inside of that diagenic clade is the Pagaristis tortugae clade. And this clade is interesting because it does have a subset of Areopagaristis in it, Areopagaristis hewittii. But Areopagaristis hewittii and Pagaristis tortugae are very similar. So they share these uniting features of cetacean and the ratio of the segments of the legs. And so they're very similar. And then in the Pagaristis tortugae complex, you see another lineage separating from Pagaristis tortugae sensu stricto. And that complex is interesting because here I have a Gulf of Mexico representative, but I also have a Caribbean, Panamanian Caribbean species. that's true when I add multiples of this this variant, you see that the distribution of those is overlapping. So we'll find them in the same region, but they're segregating genetically. And that's another one of those groups where the morphological features are either, depending on the individual, are not there or are so subtle that you have to know they're there. So you have to be specifically looking for these, you know, these ridges on the walking leg or this rostrum. It's got a little bit of a different shape, but it's not, you know, it's not a great character. But you do have color characters. So again, we're seeing this throwaway character potentially being very significant. And here's our variant. Olive color with these great, very consistent red spines. You'll see those even in preservation. So, and then our sort of peachy pink color. The bands on the eye stalks, we'll talk about that in a minute, but that could be another interesting story. So inside that complex again, we had our Areopagaristis group down here. We've got those Pagaristis tortugae and near tortugae up here. And when we take that clade and we look at the two sister complexes that make up that clade, and we draw a dividing line straight through the clade, we can see that there's two sort of color sets developing. So we have a banded eye stalk color set up here with these banded eye stalks, and even our variant, our tortugae variant, shares that trait. And then down here in this sort of mixed Pagaristis, Areopagaristis clade, we see blue head appendages and blue banding. And that's consistent. This coloration is not dimorphic. So we don't have any sexual dimorphism, and we see it broadly distributed geographically. So I can't quantitatively tell you what that is, or in terms of character evolution, be able to describe that numerically. But I think that it's a place that we could go for further questions. Phylopyrus helpousi, these are pagurids. So these are not related to that non-monophyletic large diagenic family. This is a different family, and in Phylopyrus we see a similar theme. So we see someone falling out genetically here and here, and we've got a distinct difference in color, but the morphology is very cryptic. So it's possible that this sort of this color as a character translates to other families as well as diagenically. So genetically, molecularly, we're supporting some preliminary work that suggests that diagenic Bay is not monophyletic. We have potentially some variants near tortugae and humi that are cryptic but may have a more of a story there. And then Phymopyrus helthousi in that complex inside of Pagaridae here in pink may be showing a similar shape. So I think really this research is really a jumping off point where we can really start to combine historical morphological data that we have decades of and apply molecular techniques to try to direct us to look at this interface between genotype and phenotype. So that's kind of my goal. And I just would really like to thank